Reverend Kim Polchow from Marshfield United Methodist Church and the Streams YouTube channel here at the Ice Park again, getting ready for a hockey game. Actually, we're between the first and the second period, and there's a Zamboni going by right there. So we have a member of our church, Kira Melvin, who worked really hard to get the Zamboni driver to smile, and now every period he comes out and smiles, and it's like changed the culture just because she smiled, because she tries to bring some joy. It's a fun part of every hockey game. That's Marshfield United Methodist Church in action, bringing joy. I hope you have a great week. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the streams.
Today, I'm going to tell you the story of Balaam's donkey. But before we get to Balaam's donkey, I'm going to tell you what led up to the story of Balaam's donkey, because if we just read the whole story in scripture, we will get lost in the weeds. So the Israelites have left Egypt with Moses. They're wandering in the desert, making for the promised land. Moses is still alive, but not for long. They've had two recent military conquests. They've multiplied in their 40 years of wandering, and now they're headed towards Moab. And the Moabite king, Balak, is worried. So he calls on Balaam. And this is confusing because the king is Balak and the prophet is Balaam. Balaam is not an Israelite, but he talks to God. He talks to people too. He's who Balak sends to give people big messages. He's sort of like Balak's director of communications. And Balak, the king, wants Balaam, the prophet, to go curse the Israelites as they come into the area, right? They've had military conquests. So when they come to Moab, man, you better get up there and curse them. Balaam asks God if he can do that. And God says, no, don't do anything and don't say anything. So Balaam tells Balak's messengers he cannot do what Balak is asking him to do. They offer whatever he wants. If he'll just do what Balak asks, Balaam talks to God and God says, okay, go, but only do what I tell you. So here's the story of Balaam's donkey.
This is Numbers 22:21-39. Balaam got up in the morning, saddled his donkey, and went with the Moabite officials. But God was very angry when he went, and the angel of the Lord stood in the road to oppose him. Balaam was riding on his donkey, and his two servants were with him. When the donkey saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with a drawn sword in his hand, it turned off the road into a field. Balaam beat it to get it back on the road. Then the angel of the Lord stood in a narrow path through the vineyards, with walls on both sides. When the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, it pressed close to the wall, crushing Balaam's foot against it. So he beat the donkey again. Then the angel of the Lord moved on ahead and stood in a narrow place where there was no room to turn, either to the right or to the left. When the donkey saw the angel of the Lord, it lay down under Balaam, and he was angry and beat it with his staff. Then the Lord opened the donkey's mouth, and it said to Balaam, "What have I done to you to make you beat me these three times?" Balaam answered the donkey, "You have made a fool of me. If only I had a sword in my hand, I would kill you right now." The donkey said to Balaam, "Am I not your own donkey, which you have always ridden to this day? Have I been in the habit of doing this to you?" "No," Balaam said. Then the Lord opened Balaam's eyes, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the road with a sword drawn. So he bowed low and fell face down. The angel of the Lord asked him, "Why have you beaten your donkey these three times? I have come here to oppose you because your path is a reckless one before me. The donkey saw me and turned away from me these three times. If it had not turned away, I would certainly have killed you by now, but I would have spared the donkey." Balaam said to the angel of the Lord, "I have sinned. I did not realize you were standing in the road to oppose me. Now, if you are displeased, I will go back." The angel of the Lord said to Balaam, "Go with the men, but speak only what I tell you." So Balaam went with Balak's officials. When Balak heard that Balaam was coming, he went out to meet him at the Moabite town on the Arnon border at the edge of his territory. Balak said to Balaam, "Did I not send you an urgent summons? Why didn't you come to me? Am I really not able to reward you?" "Well, I've come to you now," Balaam replied, "but I can't say whatever I please. I must speak only what God puts in my mouth." Then Balaam went with Balak to Kiriath Huzoth.
In mid-2020, remember that year? COVID, murder hornets, strange seeds in the mail from China, protests. A 10-minute hailstorm destroyed all the roofs in my neighborhood. And I called the roofing company my neighbors were using and my insurance company. And the roofing company representative insisted on being on my roof with the insurance adjuster. So I had to coordinate an appointment between the two of them, which is my favorite thing in the world to do. And they set it for 9:30 on a Monday morning, which is my favorite day to spend getting up early and dealing with stuff. The doorbell rang at 9 a.m. and I walked out of my house to find the insurance adjuster. He told me all he was about to do, and I listened and then said, yeah, but not until 9:30, which is our appointment time and when the roofing company will be here, right? Because I arranged all of that. The adjuster took a step back, checked his notes, and then started spiraling out loud over this minor error he made, like all the reasons he was feeling like an idiot. Something inside me said, pay attention now. There's a reason this guy is here. So I deliberately started a different conversation with him. I told him I had noticed when he called on caller ID that he was from a small town in another state. And I knew that town because my friend Brandy used to pastor there and I'd visited her there. He was amazed that I was friends with a pastor. You know, I don't usually start conversations with, I'm a pastor, because it feels like playing a card and it often inhibits real conversation. People think they need to talk to me in their Jesus voice and not their real voice, and that annoys me, and then I just sort of stop talking. So I explained to him that Brandy and I went to seminary together. Are you a pastor? He asked. Yeah, I'd been a pastor for 15 years at that point. So this stranger, my insurance adjuster, told me he needed my help. He'd been a pastor in the church he'd grown up in, and he'd been let go after an extremely short time. And he wanted to know how to do ministry long term because he didn't. Now, he said it was because he couldn't take the words freaking, darn, and heck out of his sermons. A statement he repeated several times that I found very entertaining each and every time, because I don't say freaking, darn, and heck in sermons or, you know, in life outside of sermons because I'm an adult. His story just poured out and I could hear all his loyalties pulling him in different direction. His church loyalties and his loyalty to God and his family loyalty and his political loyalties, which he proclaimed loudly on Instagram to 30,000 followers. His loyalty to people of color in his life. And it was just a real life big mess. I listened from this unique position of really the last person he expected to run into, and somehow the most appropriate person to see what he couldn't see and point it out. Balaam, too, was under a lot of pressure. There are a couple of major loyalties battling it out in Balaam's life. When your king tells you to say what your king wants you to say and you work for that king, that's it. That's pressure. Balaam's not an Israelite, but the God of the Israelites speaks to and through him. So who is he going to be loyal to? The God of the Israelites or the king of the Moabites? And I think God knew there was going to be an issue with these competing loyalties, which is not something God likes, which is why God got mad and why God sent an angel, and ultimately why he made Balaam's donkey open his mouth and talk to Balaam, this unexpected and yet appropriate speaker who could see what Balaam couldn't see and point it out. You know, I was Balaam's donkey to the adjuster. I was his client for his day job, a stranger from another state, a woman, a progressive Christian. Let me just say that to that evangelical, non-denominational baby former pastor, meeting a long-term seminary-trained, open-minded female professional pastor was like finding a donkey that could talk. I was a flying talking donkey. I pointed out a few things he couldn't see because of all the noise of his competing loyalties. And by the time the roofing guy came, he was jotting down books I was recommending to help him navigate through it on his own when we hit 9:30 on the dot and our conversation stopped and the appointment began. I was an unexpected conversation partner to him, a talking donkey, but I was the one God sent him to. So in that half hour, he trusted me. It's humbling to realize you've been Balaam's donkey to someone, you know, the thing they least expected to pop up with a word about what they're not seeing. But while I revealed to him a couple of blind spots to watch out for, the conversation revealed to me that people are often feeling a lot of pressure from their competing values and loyalties. And sometimes God sends someone to point out what you can't see that you need to see. And the thing that catches me about this story is that God used something to get to Balaam, something unexpected, his donkey, but also something he trusts, right? Hear this part of the scripture again. Then the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey, and it said to Balaam, and this is the voice I use for one of my dogs, "What have I done to you that you have struck me these three times?" Balaam said to the donkey, "Because you have made a fool of me. I wish I had a sword in my hand. I would kill you right now." But the donkey said to Balaam, "Am I not your donkey, which you have ridden all your life to this day? Have I been in the habit of treating you this way?" And Balaam said, "Now, I've learned in my life to pay attention when I get a certain feeling when someone I trust says something to me. It must be a Holy Spirit thing. For them, we're just having a regular conversation. But all of a sudden, I get that feeling. I got on the front porch when the insurance adjuster was spiraling. Like, pay attention now. It's like I hear it louder than they said it, and I can't forget that they said it. So a few months ago, Pastor George from the Marshfield Christian Church made a comment to me, and it was really loud in my head, and it just kept echoing. I have thought about it at least once a week since he said it, and it was just this offhand comment. And just in case I hadn't heard it, he said it again recently. But, you know, I am busy. I have so many things to figure out, and I'm always stuck in this press among loyalty to my family, loyalty to my congregation, loyalty to God, loyalty to who God made me to be. And these forces don't always want the same thing out of me at the same moment. But, you know, that is what I trained for. I'm a professional pastor. I can do this. I can do this. But honestly, I've been doing this for months with about three or four burning questions in my mind about where the church is going to go from here and how long I can keep going at the pace I've been going since I came to Marshfield and what kind of help do we need to get things done. But I don't talk about this very much because I can do this. And then the conference mandated a two-day training in Columbia, which I totally had time for. And on the way, I called my friend Brandy and I told her an element of the training that had me just spiraling in anxiety. And then, as Brandy does, she began to pick through the files of my brain. What else was I thinking about? What's going on? What's driving the train of your anxiety? Tell me about this file. And she got to my burning questions, those things that were really driving the train of my anxiety. She pointed out some things I couldn't see, and suddenly I felt a lot safer because now I could see some of what was hiding in my blind spots. So I got to the conference the next day, and I had to find my seat, which is a nightmare for an INTJ. I wanted to sit at a table alone, but then you can't control who sits with you and which table is going to both let me not talk if I don't want to talk, but then actually listen if I do decide to talk because I'm an INTJ. I sat with a pastor I knew who told me as soon as I sat down, this is an introvert's table. And I was like, you are my brother. And then another pastor I don't know as well asked if he could join us. His church in a different district is growing like Marshfield is. And I think we've both figured out that other pastors really don't want to hear about what's going on, it's not because they're not excited or they're competitive, but it's just, it's rough out there for mainland churches. And if your church is doing well, like we don't have the same problems. And so, you know, you get a lot of like, oh yeah, the struggle's real for you. So we ended up together for the main session. And then we went to the first breakout session together and we were able to just sort of turn toward each other and process some things about the pace we're going and how, you know, we might be able to shift some things to lessen the pressure we feel, because frankly, we serve a God who doesn't quit and we don't know when to quit. We don't know when to quit working for God and just be with God. I didn't sleep well that night. I could hear the outstanding things these people, Pastor George, Pastor Brandy, Pastor Brett, had said, all echoing in my head until I finally saw the picture at 4:30 in the morning. I waited till 6:30 until I called a council member to talk about it. And then later I called our council chair and she just let out this whoosh of relief because she knew the pressure I was under and she knew it had to give and she recognized that it was starting to leave. So when a friend of 30 years took me to dinner Tuesday night and asked me a couple of hard and astute career and church life balance questions, I realized God was using the time I had to go away to send me people I trusted, to show me what I couldn't see, and to keep me going in a healthy direction. But when that friend popped out with those additional questions, I just wanted to look up and say, well, you don't quit, do you? And that's the thing. That's the thing. We have free will. But when God has a preferred outcome for our decisions, God doesn't quit showing us the way. We have to learn to watch and listen, to pay attention. When our ears perk up and something someone says keeps echoing in our heads, being a pastor, yeah, it's a call from God. God chooses us, but it's not because we're special in some way. We're not more Christian than the people in our pews. Let me say that again. We are not more Christian than the people in our pews. We're not the masters of faith or the ones who always get it right. We don't get up in front of the church because we're better at life. I mean, I spent several days with pastors last week, and I swear we spend our time just looking at each other thinking, boy, God, just be calling anybody. We are pastors because God ordered us to be, and at least once in our lives, we listen to God. So a lot of our call stories, including my own, are like Balaam and the donkey. We kept trying to go another way, and we had to be told over and over and over and over again in dramatic ways until we could not miss the message. Because when God has a preferred outcome, God doesn't quit. God has a preferred outcome for the direction of this church. And so God is not going to quit to make sure that I see it. And God has a preferred outcome for my year. And so God is not going to quit until I realize I need to sit down sometimes. It's a tough season. Our loyalties among our friends, our beliefs, our thoughts, our opinions, our families, their decisions, their opinions, we're not the same. I don't mean pastors and people. I mean, you and all the people you know, we're not the same. And we don't think about everything in the same ways. But we're together in whatever way we're together because we have some loyalty to God. And God still demands our loyalty, even in tough seasons when our loyalties are pulled. And God will show us what we can't see, often through someone we trust. And if we can't get that through someone we would never expect, lion talking donkeys, those trust relationships matter. That's why God used Balaam's own donkey. At the end of the story, Balaam opens his mouth and blesses the Israelites again and again as they come into Moab. Even though he wasn't an Israelite, even though his king demanded he see something else, but because the donkey helped him see what he couldn't see, that his strongest loyalty needed to be with the God who spoke to him, even through a donkey. the God who doesn't quit. Our God never quits loving us, never quits working for us, never quits when God has a preferred outcome for our decisions and our lives. And sometimes we just need to rest in that knowledge, pay attention, not get lost in the weeds. Trust the donkeys around us and keep our primary loyalty on God, who never, ever quits. Amen.